This is a CBC podcast.
Tanse, Anine, Bujou, hello and welcome. This is Unreserved on CBC Radio 1. I'm Rosanna Dearchild. This past week, Canada marked Orange Shirt Day, a day designed to educate people about residential schools and the impact they had on Indigenous communities. On the same day, 2,800 names on a scarlet banner 50 meters long was held up and honored. The names of children who never came home from those schools. But there were many more who died. Their names unknown. This is a part of Canada's history that touches almost every Indigenous family in this country, including mine. My mother, Edna, went to three different schools. She was taken when she was just 5 years old. My mother didn't talk about what happened there, not for a long time. It remained an unnamed monster that hid inside her for over 50 years. It would take her down the dark paths of addiction and abuse until it almost consumed her. And I, the youngest of six kids, didn't understand why she was the way she was. All I knew was that I must not be lovable, that there must be something wrong with me. I wouldn't know her truth until I was an adult, when she couldn't stay silent anymore. My mother finally named that monster. Her story would spill out in tears, rage, and gut-wrenching pain. It was a story that I vowed to tell over and over so no one would ever forget. Today on Unreserved, we honor our residential school survivors. Sit with us, hear these stories, and remember. In August, the teepee that sits outside the National Center for Truth and Reconciliation in Winnipeg was vandalized. Rye Morin, director of the NCTR, responded, with disappointment obviously, but also by inviting people to come here and see what this place is all about. The National Center for Truth and Reconciliation is the archive of all the material collected during the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. In this building are 7,000 statements of residential school survivors, 500,000 documents, and a list of 4,000 students who died in the schools. And with Orange Shirt Day happening earlier this week, a day designed to educate Canadians about residential schools, it seemed like the perfect time to take them up on that offer. Hello, Rye.
Hi.
So why did you decide to respond in this act of vandalism with an open invitation to the public?
We talked with our elders and our members of our governing circle when the teepee was vandalized, because it actually really affected some of the student population, some of the staff here, quite profoundly. It really, I think, was very discouraging and even frightening for some people. So we had a brief chat. We said, you know, let's turn this into yet another educational opportunity. Let's make sure that we turn this around and we show our resilience. We're going to take this teepee down, we're going to have it repaired, and we're going to put it right back up. If this ever happens again, we're going to do the exact same thing. We will not let our home be destroyed any longer, I think. We have left the scars visible on this teepee as well, and we have done so very consciously with bright red thread that almost resembles stitches to show that the current reality for Indigenous peoples is still one where we have to deal with racism and oppression and violence today while still doing our jobs, while still trying to raise our families, while still going to work every day, while still trying to make this country a better place for all Canadians.
For listeners who haven't been to the National Center for Truth and Reconciliation, what happens here?
We have a mandate that was given to us through the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and requires us to conduct our work in a spirit and manner consistent with the goals of the TRC. So each and every day we protect the collection, we make sure that it's still here so that we stand on guard of future revisionist type activities. We share that collection with families, with survivors, with communities. We educate the public to the best we can. You know, we remember and honor and acknowledge all of those children that never came home from the residential schools. And we try our level best to discover new insights into what happened, what's happening, and the change that we need to make so that this never happens again.
So obviously these stories and these statements and this history is something that people want to know. How long will you keep these documents and these stories and this proof of what happened here?
We're required to keep them forever. And when I say forever, I mean forever. And that's a very long time, especially when you're dealing with digital information. So it's actually a huge responsibility that the center carries, is to preserve digital information forever. So we have a big responsibility on our hands, and it's a sizable part of our work just preserving this collection and making sure that it's properly honored in that regard. Now, the inverse of that, though, too, is that we operate on the basis of trust with communities. So survivors, for example, can pull their statements out of here, and they can also request the materials, say, be taken offline if we put the wrong stuff up. The way that we preserve this archive is to maintain the trust that we have with communities, and we don't take that for granted for a second. That was something we had to earn at the TRC. It's something that we've had to re-earn again at the NCTR and have to re-earn each and every day we show up and do our work.
Now, if there is one thing that you could show Canadians here, what would it be?
I think the one thing I would like people to see is I'd like people to see the Bentwood box that sits right in the main gallery space that we have at the NCTR. The other thing, of course, that people can see here at the center as well is the list of all those children's names who didn't come home from the schools. And that was something that we just released this past week in a very, very difficult, very, very emotional, but powerful ceremony that was a culmination of countless other ceremonies that we've been holding to prepare for that day. And again, so much of what we do here is making kind of the intangible tangible, or making abstract history real, because many Canadians still don't really have their minds wrapped around this whole thing. And in that silence, people and experiences, histories are forgotten. So a big part of our effort is to make things real, and to make sure that when we do that, say for that list of children, that we show them our love and our deep commitment to ensure that they're never forgotten.
Well, let's go in and check it out and get a little tour of the center. Back up the hill. So we got some smudging happening here in the doorway. Just describe to me what the Bentwood box looks like.
So the Bentwood box is made from a single piece of red cedar that was carved by Luke Marston, an artist from the West Coast. On the front of it, it depicts the story of his grandmother's experience in residential school, where she was thrown down the stairs by nuns in the school and had her fingers very severely broken. And they never healed right to the very end of her days. Her fingers were curled back. And he said as a young boy, he always wondered why his grandmother's hand was damaged like that. And that story also speaks to so many of the stories where he didn't hear that story until quite late in his grandmother's life. She never wanted to burden him with that part of the truth, right? And we're breaking the silence inside of the Indigenous community on so much of the mistreatment that has happened. On the side of the box, there's a face, another figure with a red hand, a red handprint, kind of symbolizing the destruction and the silencing of culture. There's also the Northern Lights presented there to symbolize all of the Inuit that it attended. And on the other side of the box, the Métis are acknowledged. And it's acknowledged that Métis students did end up in the schools, and especially they ended up in the day schools, which is a whole other story that, of course, we are still coming to terms with as a country. And, of course, a process that remains difficult for many because of the lack of recognition and acknowledgement of that.
So when you look at this box and you think about all those stories and what it represents, what do you feel?
You know, it depends which part of the feeling I want to focus on, I guess. And some days I feel a lot of hope, and I feel proud for the work that we've done as a commission. You know, even perhaps some days the work that I've done as an individual. We've really worked hard to do this work, and it hasn't been easy. The inverse of that, though, is, of course, the acknowledgement of the truth and all those families. And I was saying to somebody yesterday that, you know, when we were with the Truth Commission, you know, we were in rooms and filled full of crying elders. You know, it's pretty tough. I guess sometimes when I look at that box and I think of what's in there, also very real extent, I feel a deep sense of frustration, sometimes even anger.
Now, as you said recently, it was just Orange Shirt Day, and that's the day to remember and educate Canadians about what happened in Indian residential school so that we never forget. You do a lot of education also here and abroad, and you teach all over the place, spreading this knowledge. Are we making any headway? Are we getting any closer to something?
We're making pretty great headway, actually, as a country, considering how fast 10 years goes by. The commission started in 2009. Residential schools were not in any curriculum anywhere. They were literally still not in any K-12 system. Maybe they were being discussed in universities. They certainly weren't in mandatory public education for public servants either. 10 years later, it's everywhere. Almost, I would say, almost every single school in the country is doing something for Orange Shirt Day. And if they didn't do it this year, likely they'll be doing it next year. Like, it just continues to build momentum. And what's beautiful about Orange Shirt Day is that it was started by a survivor. And it's a grassroots movement. It wasn't a government-initiated thing. It's not mandated. People just felt like it's the right thing to do.
All right. Thank you very much for the tour and for sharing some time with me today, Rye.
Thanks for having me.
Rye Morin is the director of the National Center for Truth and Reconciliation. After the teepee that sits outside was vandalized in August, it was taken away for repairs, but it was raised again today. This is Unreserved on CBC Radio 1, Sirius XM 169, and Native Voice 1. I'm Rosanna Deerchild. Still ahead, he's been given items from residential school survivors and turned them into art.
So I opened the box and I held the shoe, and I could still remember the emotion that overwhelmed me at the time. I started to talk, and I was telling this shoe what I was doing, and I was also in the process verbalizing, maybe for the first time, the care that I was going to have to give to not only the people but the pieces.
Carrie Newman talks about the witness blanket. Still ahead on the show, an invitation, a road trip, and a lifetime of unspoken memories. When Caitlin Swan asked her grandmother to tell her about her experiences in residential school, she knew it was a lot to ask.
I'm nervous. I feel guilty that I've never asked about her life, but I've also just been scared to. I only saw what I wanted to see. Through the cracks of my fingers, I saw an advocate, a survivor, an elder. But now that I'm a journalist, I live in that space of feeling uncomfortable, asking questions, telling other Indigenous people's stories. But I don't really know my own.
In just a few minutes, you'll hear what happened when Caitlin and her kukum climbed into a big black Nissan truck and headed off down the highway. This is Unreserved on CBC Radio 1, Sirius XM 169, and Native Voice 1. I'm Rosanna Deerchild. Today on the show, we're talking about the lasting harm done by Indian residential schools and how people are turning to education and to art to tell those stories.
It starts with my cultural upbringing. In my Kwakwaka'wakw tradition, we wear our blankets in ceremony. We have button blankets that identify who we are and what family we come from and tell the story of our lineage. In my Coast Salish culture, we use blankets in healing. If people are going through difficult times and they need to be strengthened, then we stand them up in the community and wrap blankets around them. And then when I think about my settler ancestry, My grandmothers made quilts. My aunts made quilts. And I was looking for something that would be sort of a universal symbol of bringing people together. And I think that that's why I came up with blanket. We wrap our babies in them when they're born. We shroud our loved ones in them when they move on. And that was the reason I chose blanket over wall or some other sort of structure.
That's artist and master carver Carrie Newman talking about the inspiration behind his work, The Witness Blanket. From a distance, it looks like giant quilts hung in a row. There are the familiar star, diamond, and rectangle shapes pieced together to make a whole. But get closer, and another story unfolds. Instead of fabric, the wood frames hold children's shoes, moccasins, braids of hair, hockey skates, Bibles, bricks, and mortar, all puzzled together in a 40 by 10.5 foot monument. All of these items were collected from residential schools, churches, government buildings, and cultural structures all across Canada, and woven together to create the witness blanket. Carrie Newman joins me from Victoria. Welcome, Carrie.
Hello, how are you today?
I'm well, thank you. So, Carrie, tell me, where did this idea come from?
I guess it started back in 2010 when the Truth and Reconciliation Commission released their call for commemoration initiatives. And I set about trying to figure out what I could make that could tell the story of residential school history in Canada. My father is a residential school survivor, and so I grew up knowing a little bit about what that meant. Most of my career has been spent carving and creating things like totems and masks and jewelry and sculptural things where I start with a mass of something and whittle it down to something smaller. But it didn't seem to matter how big I imagined making one of those pieces. I couldn't encompass the story I wanted to tell. And so eventually I landed on the idea of gathering objects. And after struggling for months, actually, trying to think of how I could assemble them, I was sitting in my living room and I had my feet up on this little stool that's small pieces of wood strung together. And I looked down there and I had my aha moment. Mm. If I gathered pieces of residential schools and I could string them together in this way and I could make a blanket out of them. Mm.
But you didn't create this blanket alone. Tell me about how you collaborated with community for the project.
Well, first of all, I had a really wonderful team that helped to travel across the country and gather pieces and talk about this project and ask people to participate, ask survivors to share pieces, ask communities to share pieces. And with those pieces came so many stories.
And all in all, how many communities did you visit and how many people did you speak with?
I think we went to somewhere in the neighborhood of 75 or 80 communities, and we spoke with over 10,000 people.
Wow. What was the first item that you got that made you realize this was going to work?
One of the ones that really resonated with me was the child's shoe that's on the blanket or boot. Rosie Hartman, who was on this collection, brought back this child's shoe, and it was gathered from the site of a burned-down residential school in Carcross. It was plucked out of the bushes. She brought it back to her bed and breakfast, and that night she woke up in the middle of the night having a nightmare, and she was running in her sleep. And she packed up and headed home that day. And that evening, her husband had the exact same dream and the exact same experience. Wow. And so early the next morning, I got a knock at my door and it was Rosie, and she brought me the shoe and in a little box. And she told me the story and she said, I had to bring it to you right away because I feel like there's a lot of energy and power with this. And I feel like I have to tell you about my and my husband Shane's experience so that you know what this carries. Mm-hmm. And so I took it into my studio, which was in my home at the time, and was trying to figure out how do you deal with something that carries that much spirit and emotion. And so I opened the box and I held the shoe and I could still remember the emotion that overwhelmed me at the time. I started to talk and I was telling this shoe what I was doing. And I was also in the process verbalizing maybe for the first time the care that I was going to have to give to not only the people but the pieces, the objects. So that one really stands out for me because it came very early on, and I think it was my first inkling of the kind of power that this project may have.
And once you had the hundreds and hundreds of items in one place, what were you feeling as you started putting this monument together?
I guess I felt daunted, overwhelmed. We had this great, huge pile of bins of pieces from all over the country. And we all stood in a circle around it. And seeing the amount of objects was pretty powerful. It was pretty overwhelming. And so from there, I started to sort of take inventory and measure each piece and hold them and turn them in my hands. And that was – I guess that's the beginning of that process of how do you puzzle these things together over time.
Wow, that sounds really intense. I can't imagine what that would be like to hold each little piece, even just the story about the shoe. I mean, you've said that it is the most important work that you've ever done. Why?
I'm still learning. Why? I think that it has to do with the timing of the project, because every year we lose survivors. Every year we lose residential school sites. They're transformed, they're changed, they're torn down, or they burn. And so there's a timeliness to those pieces and those stories. And there's a precarity to them because I couldn't go back and do it all over again and make the same thing. But really, I think that the power and the importance lies in the stories and in the way that when you put them all together, they reach out into people's hearts. I was doing this project because my father's a residential school survivor mm-hmm. and because I wanted to know more and I wanted other people to know more. But starting out and holding all of those pieces, I definitely felt the weight of all of that history and the weight of that responsibility that comes with the trust that came when people gave their stories and pieces to me.
Mm-hmm. Was it healing for you, or how did it change you?
It was definitely healing for our family. It really brought me closer to my father, and I hope that it becomes a record for my daughter so that she doesn't have anything to heal from. So yeah, I would say that it was deeply healing for me, and it was also really transformative because there's a realization that happens somewhere along the line when you're holding all of these pieces and hearing stories from different survivors in different corners of this land. And the realization is just how well planned and executed the residential school system was. Mm-hmm. And there comes a little bit of anger with that. It's in response to people who in these times today still think or still say that residential schools were well-intentioned. Because when you look at the floor plans of the buildings, when you hear the stories of how students were treated, it was a plan, and it was a plan to remove our languages. It was a plan to disrupt our families, and it was a plan to take away our future indigeneity. And it almost worked. And so that's when – I guess when you have all those pieces from all those different places, you see the similarities. And that's something that I don't know if I could have imagined thinking, because you have to be in it and holding all of them at the same time to start to see how well connected all of those things are.
Mm-hmm.
I have this theory that when something becomes personal, it becomes important. And once it's important, then you're willing to commit to making change. And so for me, with the witness blanket, that's what it is. It's this collection of memories. And those memories have the potential to unlock the memories of non-Indigenous people and draw them in through – into this story, into learning more about the colonial history of Canada.
Mm-hmm. Carrie, thank you so much for your time and sharing this with us today.
You're very welcome. Thank you for having me on and giving me a chance to talk about it.
Carrie Newman is a master carver and creator of the Witness Blanket. The blanket has been replicated and is currently on tour across the country. This is Unreserved on CBC Radio 1, Sirius XM 169 and Native Voice 1. I'm Rosanna Deerchild. Caitlin Swan grew up knowing her grandmother was a residential school survivor, but she didn't understand what that meant. It was never talked about. But a few years after she moved away from home, Caitlin wanted to know more about her grandmother's past. So she invited her to go on a road trip and revisit some of the places she's never discussed with her family. Her grandmother agreed. So Caitlin headed home, back to the prairies. Then it was just her, her grandmother, and a big black Nissan truck. Just a warning, this documentary contains some graphic descriptions of violence.
No, you're just feeling ticked.
Yes.
Feeling like a tick. I'm taking so many ticks off.
Can you see any of my hurt?
No.
No?
No.
None? Okay. Now I'm convinced.
Lorna Standing Ready is not afraid of ticks. Probably because she grew up in the bush. That's what she and a lot of other Native people call growing up on the res. She's my cook'em. That's grandmother in Cree. I'm Cree, Dakota, and a little bit of Swedish. I grew up in Regina, where there just aren't as many ticks to fight off. We've had really different lives. She came from the res, I came from the city. I'm 24, and I've never really had an adult conversation with her.
So I get an idea of how your life has gone from the beginning, chronologically. Where were you born?
Oh boy, if I can remember. I was told. I was born in the Indian Hospital, Fort Capel, April the 18th, 1944.
I'm nervous. I feel guilty that I've never asked about her life. But I've also just been scared to. I only saw what I wanted to see. Through the cracks of my fingers, I saw an advocate, a survivor, an elder. But now that I'm a journalist, I live in that space of feeling uncomfortable, asking questions, telling other Indigenous people's stories. But I don't really know my own. We tried to go back to the beginning, where it all started. The hospital my cook'em was born in. It was actually called the Indian Hospital. But when we got there, just 2 hours away, all that was left was a large concrete slab in the Coppell Valley. This happened a lot on our trip. These places that were important to her, just gone, torn down. Next, we drove up to the Fort Coppell Sanatorium. Only a few minutes up the valley from the old hospital grounds. This is where her dad spent years being treated for tuberculosis in the 50s. He always said that it was haunted.
Turn in here. I don't know, I don't think we can go any further. Oh.
What's happening?
Yeah, you can just park. They tore it down.
Was the hospital here?
Yes. My dad's building was over here.
It's over on the right.
I was gonna show you where he... where I stood on a big veranda. And I stood here. His bedroom was there. He used to talk to me from the window and told me to go to school, go to school, keep going to school, learn all you can. And then the last time I stood there, I couldn't see him because he had passed away. We didn't know.
The sanatorium was demolished in 2017.
I was hoping we would park there and I was going to walk where the band shell used to be. We'd come on a Sunday and everybody would maybe having candies and sweets and listening to the band play different songs, and we'd be visiting, sitting on the grass. I can still see the people. I was sitting on the grass and Dad and Mom wanting time to themselves, so Dad would give me money and I'd walk this way and go to the Greasy Spoon and go and get some yum yums, some candy, and then come back.
Aww.
Well, that's too bad that it's gone.
And then I had no dad after that. Always given tobacco, always given cigarettes to speak. And I speak, and then I have to do something with them.
Cookham hops out of the truck to offer tobacco and a prayer. She leaves it on the ground where the sanatorium once stood, towering over the valley. The prayer and offering is a sign of respect for the earth and the spirits who've passed on. My Cookham was deeply steeped in our culture growing up. She knew her traditions, she spoke Cree fluently, a language I don't speak at all. I mean, I know wapus and na, which means rabbit, and come here, but that's it. Choosing to use the Cree word for grandmother now is deliberate. It's my small act of reclamation. We're only about 2 hours into this trip, and I'm realizing how different we are. It was hard to be native in the city. It felt like year after year, a layer of my culture was stripped off. Someone would call me dirty or untrustworthy. It felt like the only option was to act as white as possible, whatever that meant. It wasn't until years later that I realized that was the goal of residential schools. Assimilation of Indigenous culture. My coping mechanism of trying to blend in. Cookham gets back in the truck after talking to a woman who was walking by.
That lady said they were trying to keep it as a heritage and tourism place. But money talks in this world. It's gone now.
I've known her my whole life, and it feels like the first time I'm really seeing her. For a lot of Indigenous families, it's hard to talk about the past. So much of our history is traumatic. We're always trying to keep it light. But I believe there's also healing in talking about it. And I think we gain more compassion and understanding for each other when we break down those barriers and talk about what we've been through. But it's risky. She's hardly talked about her life with her own children. The next stop was Prince Albert Residential School, a place she once wanted so badly to run away from. It was the first school she was taken to when she was only 6 years old. We're slowly walking around the old grounds. She still remembers the first night alone, after being taken away.
The room was cold. It was cold. Nobody to cuddle up with me in bed. I just curled up, hugged my knees, and I was crying.
She talks about her long hair, how it was cut short and the nuns put DDT in it. It's a harsh pesticide, treated like a bug to be squashed.
And bang! I stopped crying. And this supervisor said, "Get to sleep. Quit your crying." So I cried softly. You learn to cry without making a noise.
She's guiding me through the land where the school once stood. The building's torn down now, but I can imagine what it would have looked like. Cold and authoritative, looming over the miles of thick trees, cutting her off from everything.
It's strange coming back here. I'm in a different world when I think back. I'm like that little girl, thrown away, lost. And yet, I do as I'm told. because I'm scared. I'm scared all the time.
The more we walk, the more stories she shares. She tells me about a young girl she knew. She was missing a lot of her front teeth, and it affected the way that she ate. She was punished for it, put in a cage, and made to eat from a bowl on the ground.
They treated her like a dog, worse than a dog. And she had nothing to sleep on except bales of hay and an old blanket, an old army blanket.
How long was she there for?
I don't know. We never found out how long.
We're not alone here. Not the way she was when she was little. Modern-day sounds surround us. A lawnmower hums in the distance. There's construction on the building that now sits on this land. But as my cookum walks through the old grounds of Prince Albert Residential School, the first of a few schools she would attend, the terrible memories come flooding back.
I can't live here, but you're forced. A place of hell. So many memories. I don't want to hear them. I don't want to remember. I don't want to remember those things. But you know, the story has to be told.
Her kids have never heard this story. It's taken me so long to work up the courage to even ask. But this experience, her experience, it's an important part of Canada's history. And it's a recent history. The last residential school closed in Saskatchewan in 1996. I was 2 years old, just 4 years younger than my cookum when she was taken away. She found small ways to cope with being forced into an alien life. Memories were her escape, the only place the nuns and priests could not get to.
Berries!
She'd go back to picking Saskatoon berries, one of her fondest memories. She still picks every year. We visited one of her favorite spots on Papikis' First Nation. That's where she grew up.
Holy, they're everywhere. Are those Saskatoons?
Yes.
Can't say I've gone picking before.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Look. You won't go hungry. That's food. Food. I never went hungry on the reserve. See? We're rich. Wow, there's my old swimming hole. Look at the berries. We used to come from that way. We'd take our horses, team of horses, and we'd put them there in the shade, spread our blankets out, and we'd bring our own food to eat. We used to swim all day, a Sunday.
That water is kind of receded now, eh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It'll come back. It'll come back, always does. Isn't that ever nice? I wish I could stay here for the rest of the day. I'd pick and pick and pick. Oh, look at this, my girl. All this good fruit.
I don't have that same connection to the Riz. I'm a member of White Bear First Nation, also in southern Saskatchewan. I went there all the time as a kid to visit my Cushy, great-grandmother in Dakota. I haven't been back in over 10 years, not since my Cushy died. I remember playing outside, but feeling uneasy about the small gray house that sat at the edge of the yard. A sad energy surrounded it. I think I knew it even then. It just looked like a weathered shack. My mom told me that she'd lived there as a young girl. My cookum was pregnant in that house. This is where she lived with Herman, my biological grandfather I've never met.
He was a handsome man. I fell in love with his green eyes.
They met in residential school. My cookum still remembers him with such empathy, despite several years of severe abuse.
But it was that almighty liquor that destroyed our relationship.
The thing about the res is that not a lot changes over time. It's as beautiful as I remember it. The wind softly rustles the canopy of trees above us. Pulling up to the old house, I'm afraid of what I'll hear. As a kid, I was able to ignore this house that made me feel so uneasy. Now, I've come here just to see it with my cookum. Have her tell me what happened here. I already have some vague ideas from conversations with my mom. I know this wasn't a happy place.
Lonely life. All alone. Bringing up kids.
Well, what did it take for you to leave? What happened when you finally left him?
Oh, it took 7 years. He gave me such a good lick in my throat. I had internal bleeding in my throat. I couldn't talk.
Even though he'd beaten her for years, she remembers that he was a survivor of residential school too, and that he was battling his own demons.
Who's going to look after my kids? Who's going to do that if I'm not around? So I had to save myself. I had to leave them.
Cookum hitchhiked to Regina. She got the medical attention she desperately needed. And still, she faced struggles in the city. The social workers didn't understand what it had taken for her to even leave. She didn't want to, but she had to.
I had to be put down in social work books. I was a deserter. I deserted my family. So I took that chance, and that's what I did. Finally, realizing I had to save myself in order for my kids to have a good life.
After she left, the kids, including my mom, were put in foster care. She fought to get them out, to get a house, to find a stable job. She fought against the barriers that made it almost impossible for a Native woman in the prairies. But after 6 months, she proved to the social workers that she deserved her children back.
And they gave me the kids back. Oh, they were just like little puppies. Just hugging me and crying and kissing me. And
now when I look at her, I can see her as a young girl, then a young woman. Hearing about the love and pain in her life is filling in the blanks of a life story I never knew. The next morning, we climb into the truck after a journey that's covered over 1,000 kilometers and decades of my cookum's life. We're heading back to Regina. The wind is whipping across the prairies. Besides the wind, it's quiet in the truck. My mind is busy going over everything we've talked about the last few days. But we're not done. Starting to talk has opened something up. Something that my cookum kept hidden away for such a long time. A memory as graphic as the trauma it inflicted so many years ago.
Oh, I've seen how men could treat a young girl. My friend is still alive today. She was getting the strapping of her life. I've seen a lot of strappings. I've seen what they could do, but this was the worst.
A memory from a residential school in Manitoba. One of the worst that she went to. She describes in such disturbing detail seeing her friend strapped while she was forced to watch by her principal. I find a place to pull off the highway, and all I can do is listen as the memory comes.
And she was bleeding. Oh, bleeding so bad. She was bleeding so bad. And she fell off the table. She fainted. And he grabbed her up. He grabbed her grabbed her between her legs.
The principal's wife lived at the school. Cookham ran to go get her.
His eyes, my girl, his eyes were like glass. And he was looking happy. And she came up and she saw. Her hand went to her mouth. And then she rushed forward to him and grabbed him by the arm. And
she tells me that his wife tried to get him to stop. She yelled his name over and over and over.
He came out of his trance. And she took him by the hand and he followed her. How did we survive? You can say by the will of God. But I survived with my teachings.
Cookham is still heavily involved with the church. I grew up going to Midnight Mass every Christmas. I always wondered how she could be so close to a church that abused her.
And there was a reason for you to stick with your studies. Someone has to tell the story. And I'm so busy trying to educate the church. The very church that almost destroyed me, but not.
We sat there in silence for a while. But Cookham piped back up with a lesson that connected to her story about taking care of yourself and being strong. But my mind was in a million different places. I didn't really know what to say. And somehow, the conversation circled back to a place where she was laughing again.
And you have to learn to laugh. And I've learned to laugh. I've learned to be able to joke about life at times. Because you need that.
We listened to Elvis for the next 2 hours as we drove home. I will always wonder how these experiences shaped her life. A lot of survivors turn to drugs and alcohol, but she didn't. Somehow, she moved on. Trauma is woven into my family's history, but it alone does not define us. I've inherited strength, resiliency, and unconditional love, and those traits didn't come without a fight. My Cookham had to persevere. She had to come out the other side in order to be that foundation our whole family's built on. She's made such a difference in her family's lives. My brothers and sisters, her great-grandchildren.
I guess I would describe Grandma as persistent, tenacious.
She's nice and she's lovable.
She holds the most amount of unconditional love that I've ever known. And
she's just a joy to be around. She's been a big inspiration to pretty much everybody in our family.
Grandma's strong and she's beautiful. Grandma's my home.
This story is only a sliver of my Cookham's life. She said this nearly every day when we were driving down the highway.
So much to tell, so little time.
She's still an advocate for women's rights and Indigenous rights. She's got children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren who look up to her, who admire her. She didn't have to say yes to this road trip. She spent her whole life not sharing these stories. But something about this trip, driving hundreds of kilometers through the prairies in a big black truck, she let me in. You can't understand the strength of someone until you know the weight that they've carried. You don't know their wisdom until you know their struggle. And you don't really know them until you listen.
It's a good zoom lens. What else can I look at? birds?
There's lots to see. There's pelicans in this lake too, if you you see any of them. You can zoom in on pelicans. Wherever you see pelicans, there's fish. It's now or never,
my love. That was CBC Halifax's Caitlin Swan and her cuckum, Lorna Standing Ready, driving off into the sunset with Elvis. That documentary by Caitlin Swan was produced by Anna Lazowski as part of the Emerging Indigenous Doc Maker program. If you're an emerging Indigenous doc maker with a story to tell, you can apply for the next round. We've put a link on our site so you can find out more. That's at cbc.ca/unreserved. That's it for this week's episode of Unreserved. We'll be back in this radio space next week for more community, culture, and conversation. This episode was produced by Stephanie Cram, Kyle Muzica, Zoe Tennant, and Anna Lazowski. Special thanks to Caitlin Swan and Joan Melanson this week. If you want to get in touch with us, you can email us at unreserved@cbc.ca or find us on Facebook and Twitter. I'm your favorite cousin, Rosanna Deerchild, coming at you from Winnipeg in Treaty 1 territory. Thank you for listening to Unreserved on CBC Radio 1. Agosay.
For more CBC podcasts, go to cbc.ca/podcasts.